appreciate everybody being there. And again, I, you know, wave your hand if you can hear me. I just want to believe that you can hear me. Say hi, Joe. Hi, Joe. Okay. Hi, Joe. Hi, Joe. Yeah, there you go. You know, Melody and Susan, the work they've been doing over in what used to be my hometown, where my kids were raised in Albany with the Albany Bulb, is really the reason I'm here. I mean, Susan's inspired a lot of intersection of place and art and story. And that work, you know, is something that we think is very important at my organization, StoryCenter. So we've been part of the support mechanism for that as well. I can't help but think that 38 years ago, I was a student there at Berkeley, and you know, a lot of life has happened in between those years. But you know, I kind of really appreciate that campus. I'm 2 months moved away from being a mile and a half from there, really for most of the last 20 years, between 3 miles and a mile and a half from Berkeley campus. And I'm sort of missing where you guys are at. Melody asked me to talk a little bit about storytelling and a little bit about our work in place. I'm gonna kind of roll through this. I'm gonna share a couple of digital stories as examples, and I hope you can hear them. I realize you're looking at a glary screen and it's probably partially washed out. So, you know, mainly focus on what I'm saying. I'll send all of you, or I'll send Melody the slides and then you can look at them after the fact all you want. When we talk about storytelling, we're like a social justice organization. So we're usually talking about how do you make stories visible that weren't visible? Place stories often are told by almost like that idea that the winners of a war get to tell the story. They're often told by the people who had the most power in defining the place. And so there's always a lot of work to find the ghosts in neighborhoods, the stories that made the neighborhood have character, made the city have character, make the town, and listening for them is a kind of trick. We call the broader field of using story as a mechanism for personal and social transformation, story work. And you may not have heard that phrase. We're using it a little bit more now in the last 5 or 10 years to encompass a bunch of different processes that are out there that are interrelated. And for planners, you know, the idea of having public hearings, having charrettes, having mechanisms to hear from the community that are either moving toward the community or having the community come to you is a big part of everyone's process now. Over time, we've realized that active citizenship is required to make planning work. We understand from the individual level that at different points in our lives, stories have a way of kind of working their magic on us. And whether we're the teller of the story or a listener to a story, if we hear a certain story at a developmental moment that assists us to kind of get over some history, get over some, you know, suffering, get over some trauma, that story can help us reach a kind of new period of balance. Well, the same could be said of communities. Sometimes when negative things have happened, and you'll hear a little bit of my relationship to place and negative things that happen. We need to re-earth those stories, discover them again in order to make the place work. It's just like all of us remembering that you guys are sitting on Ohlone territory, and I'm sitting here in Pueblo territory and a lot of other indigenous things. When we call those things out, we're actually changing the place again as we do it. And that moment of being ready for that, you know, we might say that we're in a moment of reawakening, or we could say we're just kind of figuring out that knowing the stories about place help us move forward. I'm gonna share a story that's an example of what a good digital story is. And I'm gonna talk about good storytelling, because I think all of us need to think about how do we communicate super effectively? And we do that by going straight to person's kind of heart as well as their head. So here's an example of a story by a woman named Denise Gant, who came through our things, based in Baltimore. She recently lost her mother, but I just want to use it and think about it as a story, a place-based story, because it's about her mother's penchant for having tomatoes in her garden. So here's Denise's story, and I hope you can hear this.
The year my mother joined her people, I planted 1,000 tomato seeds for a yard that can only sustain 10 plants. This is the kind of insanity that grief breeds. My mother died in January 2019. By February, my narrow windowsills teemed with exotic names. Azoishka, Constoluto Genovese Silvalente, Drusba. I grew so many black tomatoes, but in my haste to escape my pain, I forgot to plant seeds for my favorite black, Paul Robeson. I watched the seedlings like an expectant mother. Every day waited for their true leaves to fracture the light. I hoped my mother would show up in May when I sat on the rusted chair, played Nina Simone in a haze of Nag Champa, and transplanted the seedlings to their final resting place. In July, I imagined she grew as impatient as I was, waiting for that first ripe tomato. My mother despised mayonnaise and preferred her love apples almost naked. She sliced them open, placed salt on their innards, then swoon. A foodie long before there was such a word, she learned to make spaghetti sauce from an Italian woman she babysat for in Philadelphia during the 50s. In 1969, we became the first black family on the block in a Lovett suburb, but Maryland never became home to my mom, AKA Aunt Sis, Nana, E.T. She wrote a children's story she loved to read me about an African princess named If Me, had an IQ of 180. My mom left so many dreams unmet, wobbling on the kitchen floor. Until the multiple myeloma came, she loved to brag, "No one in our family ever gets cancer." In October, I was still clipping diseased leaves from the plants in a futile attempt to stop the death. But everything that makes the soil sweet comes from decomposition. My mom weighed less than 90 pounds the last time I saw her alive. As her breath waned, the plants outside her hospice window whistled in the cold evening air, like the dead plants I just couldn't bury. My brother thinks I should grow fewer, but I won't. Growing tomatoes is the one place where I can find my mother and not collapse. In my garden, salt tastes like sweat, not sorrow. If I could, I would plant 1,000 acres of love apples. And even that would not be enough to cry her back to me.
Oh, come on. And again, I'm not sure how well you could hear that story. I'm sure in the back of the room there, it was probably hard. You'll get a sense, but it's a reclamation process. It's a restorification process when you grieve loss. You're trying to take what you've lost and you're trying to name it. When we teach storytelling, we teach it from inside out. And I said that, you know, sometimes you're ready to tell the story that's going to get you in some level of comfort, if not transformation. And that starts with not just telling the story the way you've already always told it, because there's no learning there. It's telling the story in a new way, in a new insight that makes you see something there that's useful for this moment moving forward. When you're working on a process, a project, you're always trying to find a kind of new angle on it. And part of the reason you're trying to find an angle on it that surprises or awakens something in others is that we're always looking for something we didn't know before. And we call that originality, right? But from us as storytelling teachers, we're mainly listening for what the person needed to know that they probably hadn't figured out yet. And the trick to that is an insight that also looks at the way our body is holding the deepest stories we have. All of us know, you know, George Lakoff there at Berkeley has written a lot about the way emotion affects our reason, and that a lot of our choices, when we're making them with our big, quick reptilian brain, come from emotive spaces that are profound. They're where we come from in family. They're where we come from in the experiences we've had, negative and positive, that tell us we lean this way or we lean this way. But part of storytelling is knowing, you know, I've got that story inside me. And I know that that's pushing me forward. It's making me passionate about something. But it's also shaping my confirmation bias. And a good storyteller should be self-aware to the degree that their stories are kind of written over by these big emotional processes. And for all of us, that's a trick to get there. And I'm not gonna go through all of these things, but usually as a listener, we're waiting for a person to go back and reinterpret a given experience, a moment in time, you know, meaning we don't watch movies where somebody tells us a big, broad narrative. We watch them in scenes. And when we look at the scene in a given way, we show that insight. So in this, you know, piece that we just saw with Denise Gant, we hear her working through her mother's, in almost her entire life, and her struggles to be as fully realized as she might have wanted to be, being obviously a super intelligent, super, you know, interesting person that may not have gotten to go everywhere she wanted to go with the skills and the wisdom that she had. But that through this story, Denise is kind of reclaiming for herself, really, the idea that we should fight to be fully realized. And that processes like gardening, making your own food, are forms of wisdom in which you're going through a natural process of ascent and decline that reminds you what the life process is, what your own ups and downs are, or in this case, your own final resting. Were you to come to one of our workshops, we would emphasize listening more than telling. Listening to others and learning for how they process big experiences and going, that's really cool, the way they've thought about it. And listening to yourself, going away, being quiet, being in a place where you can reflect and create. I'm sure many of you have creative outlets, and they don't have to be story. They could be music and dance. They can be art, they can be photography. Those outlets are chances for you to just sit inside yourself and see what you see and hear what you hear and hopefully have words for it or expressive output that you can do something with it. The idea is the same. Mainly we're creating in order to feel a sense of balance, that we've somehow dealt with what we needed to deal with, and that the monkey on our back of our, you know, life is we're able to kind of take it out and look at it and play with it. And a lot of our work in digital storytelling is allowing communities who've been affected by trauma to tell stories that allow them to take a look and say, wow, that happened to me. It was almost like, you know, this other thing that you were connected to. So I'm going to switch. I'm going to pass all these slides. and say that, you know, when I came to San Francisco in 1976, I got involved in tenants' rights organizing. And I was involved in a big battle in San Francisco Chinatown called the International Hotel. And the International Hotel was a battle over an old merchant seaman's hotel, kind of residential hotel, typical to what you'd find in Tenderloin or, you know, any other parts of San Francisco. And after 9 years, the city finally got the courage to try to kick us out, kick them out. And all the progressive organizations and other organizations that were inside the International Hotel building at Jackson and Kearney in San Francisco. And so on the final night of August 4th, 1977, 2,000 of us stood off about, you know, 400 police, including a bunch of police on horseback, for a good portion of the night. We were finally defeated as they put a hook and ladder truck and the police came in through the roof, beat the crap out of our people on top, and came down and evicted everybody. But it represented for me something that was very close to my heart, which was when we create community and legacies that are just part of the economic history of a given place, there's a residue of knowing there. And that area stood empty for 30 years, 28 years, something like that. Now there is a building and it's senior low-cost housing. And down below, there's an International Hotel museum of sorts that you can learn about this struggle and learn about these people. It was very important for the Filipino American community, this is right next to Chinatown, to be able to claim what that was about for them. Because a lot of Filipinos were kind of kicked out of San Francisco, first to build the Moscone Convention Center, and then to build this little part of the end of Chinatown. To create this, and people wanted to remember that. And a lot of what was going on is a kind of reaction to what had been, you know, the I don't even think it was well-meaning perspective about urban renewal and redevelopment that was kind of given a lot of American communities and cities, and then there's some rural areas from the period of 1950 to 1990 as a, you can't stop us, the bulldozers are coming. And there's been resistance of all kinds. And I was really interested in what came out of Chicago, you know, James McKnight and others created this idea of asset-based community development, because the argument about bulldozing a neighborhood was, well, it's so bad, we'll fix it. And there was no assessment of what was good, what you should keep, what should stay there. There was just like, well, it's a mess, so let's just bulldoze it. And, you know, invariably, if you were rich and powerful, you didn't get bulldozed. But if you were poor and a person of color, you did get bulldozed. And so a lot of people organized back by saying, well, let's hear the stories of what works and let's plan out of that. You know, Michelle Obama was on the board of the asset-based development group in Chicago. And really, a lot of people began to change their perspective because of that work and work of people like Mindy Fullilove out of Columbia University, who wrote the book Root Shock. And it was Root Shock and a collaboration with an African-American filmmaker and film historian named Carol Blue that got me into story mapping in relationship to the similar things I was fighting back at the Aya Hotel, which was, how do we not let communities get bulldozed? And how do we sustain their historic identity and yet allow economic change and development to happen? Her work, she grew up in a neighborhood called the Third Ward in Houston, Texas. I'm gonna skip over that, go straight to this story, and then go, where's the Third Ward? Oh, they got knocked out. Where's my Third Ward slide? There it is. And it happens, I grew up in Texas. My parents were both civil rights and union activists. I knew a lot about politics in Texas. I certainly knew about the ward politics of predominantly African-American Houston, Texas. My family was connected to, you know, many of the leaders of those communities, both in Dallas and San Antonio, Austin, and Houston. And so I found myself working there in the later 70s. After I come to California, I moved back to Houston, living in the Third Ward. Third Ward is also where got my brain. George came from, George from Minnesota. Well, I had my brain. You know who I'm talking about. The man who was murdered last year by the police. There had been a creeping redevelopment in the community very close to a historic park called Emancipation Park. And I had just done some work in Northern California connecting map points and stories to the larger kind of redevelopment plan for Mendocino County. We brought the same idea into Houston to create stories that would influence the both investment in the historic part of that community. And there were great organizations like Project Row House that also worked in that community, restoring and valorizing local community institutions that had tremendously interesting histories. And we did that. We had six different workshops, a lot of interesting people collaborating, but a lot of local stories about the history before desegregation. You know, a lot of historic communities were affected by desegregation in an odd way. When richer people from the community could move out, it tended to cause economic decline within the community. Oddly, segregation had, you know, kept the doctors and lawyers and the teachers living in their community because they didn't have a choice. And the shifts, as well as just the resource removal by city governments to make poor neighborhoods even poorer, had affected this neighborhood. And this was part of the struggle to get that. And the good news is there were some positive changes. You know, I have a lot of examples of these, but I can't help but want to call out New Orleans today. As you know, 1 million people in Louisiana lost their power last night. Exactly a Sunday to Monday in line with when Hurricane Katrina hit. And we all know, you know, that was a perfect example of using a disaster to do terrible things to local community members. Right as that happened, my organization supported a group of people doing eyewitness stories. And they went around and put signs up all over the neighborhood where you could call and hear the story on the telephone. We did it, you know, they did it in Central City. They also did it in the Bywater, which, you know, you have French Quarter, Barony, and Bywater in the neighborhoods that were sort of more directly affected. Central City wasn't that affected. But again, historically, a low-income neighborhood that was being greatly affected by gentrification post-Katrina. And, you know, we did a different kind of workshop model coming out of our place-based work where we used, you know, the iPhone as the media production tool, once it was kind of good enough to do that, to shoot and edit video. And we called it the iOS story workshop, and it toured the world. But this one that we did here gave us this next story. And I want to just show one more story before I, you know, move to question and answer, because I really want to do this. This is a story by a guy named Nick Sly who grew up there. It's a story about culture. It's a story about place. And it's a story about growing up and being mature enough to talk less and do more. And hopefully you can hear this. And it's really short.
My grandfather spent thousands of hours in his dusty shed, slowly wood-burning lines into cypress, creating exact replicas of things he saw in nature. Ducks, crawfish, bass, butterflies, magnolia. He also spent ample hours learning how to make his own fly baits, testing his balance standing in a P-row, or adjusting his catfish traps by an inch, depending on the flood stage that season. All he had was time. He talked very little, did a whole lot. For a long, long time, I tended towards the talk a whole lot, do very little. So it should have been no surprise that when I announced my intent to learn the family gumbo recipe, my grandmother looked me in the eyes and said, "You're not ready." Each year around Thanksgiving, this is what she would say. She never gave a reason, but she repeated those words every year. My grandmother's name is Rita May Zerang, and she too was cut from the patient cloth like my grandfather. She remembers poor. She remembers taking time to plant the seeds right, because if you messed up the crops, no food for winter. It's no wonder she looked me up and down each year, waiting for the year when she might decide to teach me how to make my grandfather's gumbo. Today, I realized that the day she said I was ready was right around the time I started doing more and talking less, when I spent less time exalting my opinion and more time doing heavy lifting. And it really came, I think, when she knew I learned the hard way that you are who you are when no one is looking. It's what you do then that counts. Some lessons take a long time to accept.
Do I want to say anything else? I don't think so. You do these slide decks and you're like, well, you could share a lot, but you know, in fairness, I want to hear from you guys. I want this to be a little more interactive. And you know, Melody, you might want to lead me off with a question that you don't think I, you know, addressed enough, but I wanted to make sure we had plenty of time to hear from you guys, your thoughts about story, about why story is important to you, and why stories of place are important to the kind of planning processes and engagements you're going to have with communities in the future. So thank you for listening to this part. Melody, do you want to kick it off or do you want to call on people?
Hey, Joe, can you hear me? One of the things that we're distinguishing in this speaker series is what makes a place-based story different from a good story that is a good story. So can you just refresh our memory what you think are really strong elements of a good story, and how is that different from
a place?
A place, yeah.
You know, every time I've had this discussion, I've had people say, well, how can there be any good story that isn't set, rooted in a context that's very concrete, meaning a place? And I think that's true, meaning if you think about an aspect of Denise Gantz's story, it's not really about the backyard where the tomatoes are grown. It's not really about a given neighborhood in Baltimore or nearby Baltimore, in Philadelphia, you heard, you know, in Maryland, you heard. You know, it's really about the place-making processes of people who do things like gardening in order to take some possession of their environment in a way that feels constructive to them. All I'd say about good place-based storytelling is that you see context really clearly, and you provide enough nuance in the context, in what you foreground versus what you kind of leave out, that you have a sense that the person's talking about some aspect of change. You know, all stories are really about unexpected change or change you went toward, that there's something inherent in the details you give of the place that's about where it's been and where it's going, and what you caught in this snapshot of a moment that suggests some sort of decisive shift. And usually good storytellers are, you know, in place-based stories, are kind of aware of the character's movement through the context. The context is informing those choices in some clear way. I think if we thought about any movie we really liked, you'd see the setting as another character and its impact on the person who's there, whether that's like growing up in a complicated community from different marginalized kind of relationship to the mainstream. You see that world affecting the character's choices. And without that, we don't care about the character because we really need to know, well, where are they sitting? And on the flip side, if we hear a movie about rich Victorian English people doing their thing, we need to know even enough about their social context, the actual physical social context of the houses and the landscape, et cetera, that we know what they're kind of navigating, for better or for worse. So I think most of the time, Melody, I'd say a good storyteller is just ensures that there is a clarity about what that relationship is between the character's arc of change and the place's arc of change. And I think, you know, we care about those kind of stories, you know.
I think that's great to pull out the place as kind of a sub-character to a plot. And I'm interested in this kind of relationship between character as the subject and then the place as the subject. You know, I think, as you said, there's lots of films that end up being a portrait of a landscape or an environment much more than the, you know, lead themselves. Are there things that you do in storytelling, like playing with, like the linearity of story or changing the scale of the story, that help to bring out or tease out the story of the environment?
Well, when you think about our form, it's so short. I mean, we're making really short, short films, like 2 to 4 minutes. That one of the things we're using is the visual material to specify place. Inevitably, it's not necessarily what's said in the words, though I think a really good story will maybe have some descriptive prose just a little bit against whatever the visual pieces are. But I think because you're working in multiple modalities, the text, the speaking of the text, the visuals, perhaps the use of music, which gives context, which can be regional or cultural, but the visuals will suddenly put us into something, you know, that's closer to that. I didn't say about the piece I just showed, all the photographs came from a single walking tour through the French Quarter and the Marigny, those neighborhoods I talked about, New Orleans. So they weren't pictures that he had. They were pictures that were, as he was thinking about this story of growing up and his grandma giving him the gumbo recipe, the pictures he found evoked place to him, you know, wooden ducks and little shrines and cans of, you know, whatever flavoring, right, for the food. All of those things inform the story, as if, you know, without those visuals, I think the story would feel a very kind of different sense of connection to us. So that's often what, you know, is great about short storytelling and multimedia, is the images are doing so much work to remind us of location and context and something about the place in a way that is useful. And obviously all of us have the ability to take endless photographs to contextualize whatever we're working on and bring it into these multimedia stories without having to describe it. You know, like a really good novelist would paint a picture in their words. You got the picture, you're talking into it. You don't have to say what's implicit or explicit in that image. It's just shown.
So your story mapping project, it seems like one of the things we're saying is really distinctive is being able to use what's around you and use your senses, sensory experience to tell a story. Can you talk us through, you know, if I was on my phone or I was a user of the story mapping experience, what it would be like for me to geolocate?
Well, I think, you know, we've been doing a newer version of this story mapping workshop in the last, you know, as an online thing in the last year, after many years of not doing this work. Most of this work I did between 2006 and 2016. So for about a decade, I was doing more place-based work. I've come back to it in the last years because I thought the pandemic actually affords us the opportunity to spend time in our neighborhoods and our communities in new ways. And a lot of it was about, you know, what is the narrative of the particular place? So using the Third Ward example, there was a history there in which you could do oral histories about the barbershops and the nightclubs and the, you know, playgrounds and the, you know, various characters in churches in which scenes happened that gave great meaning to the story. I mean, one of the stories I want to show, and I decided it was a little bit too intense, was a guy reciting a moment at his local church. The church, Baptist church, is still there. But it was a moment in the 60s where somebody had been viciously mutilated by an act of racist violence. And it was a story that was told to the community by the minister, and they brought the guy up and they showed his you know, his scars, if you will. And it was a horrible moment, but it was sort of sanctifying that place as a place where the community came together to heal from these terrible incidents that were part of, obviously, you know, Southern racial terror, and that place needed to be held. It's like, you don't take that away. It's like a monument. It's like, and there, you knew by telling one story, you were telling million stories or thousands of stories of people using these places, using the barbershops, using the community dance hall, all things that had come into disarray, but their narratives had a big difference. So when you put those on a map for some observer from the outside to see each of those narratives, the theory, not, you know, and this is done through all other kind of research processes and journalism and oral history work and all these other kind of story work processes, to sort of say, no, it's really complex, the interrelationship of all these narratives to what the place is. And going back to asset-based community development, it means we're looking at all of the positive, you know, even if the negative is there, it's about how people responded to the negative. That's part of the legacy of the place. And you can put historical monuments up and you can, you know, sort of sanctify that through sticks in the ground with signs on it. But what's more important is that it's a continuing conversation, that the community is woven of all of these memories of what's visible and what's no longer visible, but still part of the psychogeography of the place. And by, you know, having that in one little cool Esri map that you can geolocate where those stories are, I think you get a better picture than, say, a documentary film that says, here's the history of the Third Ward community. Well, there's not one version of that history. There's hundreds of versions. And obviously filmmakers get more privileged around that. But this idea of multiplicity of narratives, I think, is really important. So the students that come to us, they're finding things that they want to connect to through that. And we're now, you know, we were using the Google API and some online, you know, ways of making maps using that available API. Now we're moving toward, you know, the Esri Story Map software, which is fairly easy to use. It's a nice publishing environment in which, you know, you can be pretty complex. And there's some amazing maps. And many of you are probably already familiar with that publishing environment, but you can get as complex as you want. And I think that that extends our little stories where communities can come together and kind of build a new map that celebrates its existence as opposed to talks about all the problems, you know.
Well, now I'm so curious what you think about the pile of sticks that I think you were using to describe monuments as a way to tell stories.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, we're in a process of shifting out, you know, our monuments, like Confederate monuments, for monuments of civil rights heroes, you know. I like the intention of that because it does leave some visible, you know, marker, but I think there needs to be more, you know, there needs to be more oomph there. There needs to be more stories and more ways that people engage with stories. I just did a project in South Texas, Melody, with high school teachers trying to bring Mexican American history into the community. And some of it was based on tours and, you know, seeing the markers and stuff. But a lot of it was like a walking story circle where people were hanging out with each other as they went to these different places and hearing the intersection of stories. Oh, my grandfather did this, or my mother did this. And in relationship to this, singular location, there's a lot of other things going on that tell, I think, a more vital story than what's the 1,000 words that it's on a little historical marker saying, here's where all these people, were massacred by Texas Rangers in 1915. Well, there's a lot that happened since then. And we know there will be a lot of stories that are right emerging from this unplaced, like around the COVID-19 impact in South Texas, that are still a legacy. It's the same legacy of what the place has suffered and how people have struggled with that suffering.
So Joe, I find a challenge early on in storytelling, and I think a lot of us are here, we work on other projects that have to do with the built environment or the community. What do you think about ownership of stories and who owns a story? I think in a lot of your workshops, you're helping people to like develop their own voice and their own stories. But do you have any advice for those of us who might be trying to work with others to tell their stories?
Well, the good news is I think most of the people who are coming of age in the 21st century sort of already have a sense of participant-centered process as a kind of citizen, as opposed to authorities-centered process. So many of us would not listen to a historian who hasn't come from any of the cultural background or any of the lived experience being the authority on the topic they're talking about. And again, we talk about it in relationship to race, gender, class, etc. We want people who've lived the story to be the ones we're listening to about the story. So inevitably that means decentering yourself. I mean, I'm a white man, and I work a lot of different communities. It ain't about me and my opinion about what happened. It ain't about how I'm going to interpret that. It's me supporting people who are going to do their own work. And so creating mechanisms like digital storytelling as a method is used by countless communities that have nothing to do with my organization, because it's just an approach. It's like, how do you make a little film? And obviously people, when they decide to use it in their way, and I'm here in a, an indigenous part of, indigenous centric part of the United States here in Santa Fe. A lot of indigenous organizations have taken participatory media models like ours, Photo Voice, StoryCorps, whatever, they've taken and they've done their own version of it. And the way they use it is the way they use it. And so I think that idea of allyship, right, Melody, it's like, you're here not to sort of walk away with your research and I get a job because I'm a good researcher. You're here to actually see the change happen in the community. And you know that you're doing what you can to have as many of those voices informing process. It's a community organizing model of change, right? It's not a policy expert model of change. Change has to come up from the bottom. It may meet really good policy people at the top, and certainly that relationship is good, important. But without the grassroots component of voice, then I don't think you're actually going to make anything stick. It won't matter that you did this good thing. And we're seeing this on like a vaccination policy. There has to be local organizing. You see it around voting rights. There has to be local organizing, because no matter what the other side is trying to do to you, if you are not responding, they're gonna do it to you. That's all I'd say. Yeah. You have to do this. What do you mean? Of course you have to listen and involve as many people as you can in any planning process.
Right. Well, sometimes it doesn't feel like there's the time to do that or the funding to do that. But I guess maybe what some of us will need to decide is where we want to sit on kind of like where our role will be, if it's closer to organizing and archiving and producing the story, or if it's kind of that connective tissue, getting it out onto bigger platforms, or if we're closer to kind of synthesizing and digesting material to make decisions. Are there any questions from anybody for Joe? Great.
I have a question.
Would you come up actually and
Hi Joe, my name is Emma.
Here's the mic. Okay, let's try this.
Hi, my name's Emma, and my question is, when you do story work, how do you imagine, or also how have you seen the act of listening by people, you know, who shouldn't necessarily be at the forefront of like creating those, you know, we should let people tell their own stories, but how do you intend or imagine or have seen the act of listening translate into action, whether at the individual level or at the community level, both in terms of like planning or environmental design, but also just within relationships between people?
You know, what I haven't really talked about is our model and the way that our, that what's the process of our workshops, Emma. And we do something called a story circle, and inherent in the story circle is everybody gets the same amount of time to talk. And the person who's the storyteller is getting the feedback that they want. I mean, it's just a form of creative feedback. And that nobody gets, you know, there's kind of a constitution to discourage people dominating discussions, people who are assertive or, you know, extroverted more than introverted, that there's balance in that. And when you do that right, and when the facilitator is leaning in, not to have their opinion manifest, not to have their point of view manifest because they're the expert in the room, but to create a mechanism of really present awareness of what's being said to you, you know, and why it might mean something, and you feel it as well as you think it, right? And you're not thinking what you're trying to say next. You're looking at the way it's impacting everybody in the room. What we see in those dynamics is a kind of transformative awareness that happens in a group. That the reason your story just got better isn't because you figured out your own story. It's because you heard that other person's story and you went, oh my God, that there's a kind of nuanced bravery in the way they're telling their story that I could find inside myself. I could talk about it in a way that I've been afraid to talk about it, but I hear the nuance of it in a way that's not like you have to disclose intimacy, but in a way that's sort of like, yeah, if you say it that way in this context about this experience, then it's going to make a difference. And the example I'll use, Emma, a lot of our work is in violence prevention, coming out of a history of work in domestic violence prevention, led by staff member Amy Hill on our staff, led us to a lot of international human rights work, et cetera, et cetera. But a lot of times when you've taken wounded people and you bring them in environments, I mean, it could be like group therapy, right? But you bring them in environments where every story really matters. There's no like, oh, your story is a more intense story than mine, or you're a natural leader and I'm not so much. I'm a little more, you know, stand back. But every story matters and everybody rises. It's a natural process. So I think you have to think about how you construct environments where every story really does matter. You have to construct an environment where everybody in the room is heard exactly the same amount of time, and nobody gets to dominate all the feedback, and nobody gets to, you know, pull the conclusions out and declare what we learned today is X. We're just holding multiplicity. And I think as sophisticated people, we can do that. And we can trust that we're going to walk away and it's going to make us think different without having to put PowerPoint summation to it. I think that's why a lot of people use digital storytelling workshop methodology as an informed process of community organizing. And especially when it's around something as hard and intimate as interfamily violence, you almost have to do it that way because nobody's got a solution around, and they're around, you know, addiction, around public health policy. Nobody's got a solution. You just have to create mechanisms where people consider a bunch of options. Did that answer your question? Am I was going too long?
Yeah, Thanks, Joe.
Hey, Joe. My name is Raphael. Thanks for being here with us. Hopefully you can hear me all right. You touched on this a bit, but just kind of going back to one of the themes of one of the videos you showed us of less and do more. When, if at all, when you're embarking in the storytelling process, are you concerned or considering impact of what you're uncovering?
How do you use this for advocacy work, right? Meaning when you're, impact usually means you're getting a decision maker to change their mind and resource something that they weren't about to resource. The way we teach it, you may have seen in that list, it had sharing your story at the bottom. I can assure you that any professional communicator is going to say, the first thing you need to know is who's your audience and how do you need to speak to those audience? So if you're speaking to decision makers like a legislative body, you're setting up stories one way and standing up. And we kind of say, the first thing you need to consider is what do these people really need to say and what it's about? We have an example, Raphael, where we went up to Inuit Labrador, working with a community under a huge Canadian health process to look at the impact of climate change on the community. And everybody, who hired us wanted a policy statement by these local people about the specific impacts of climate change on their community. You know, like, why are the moose not running? How does this affect the way, your economic vitality? Can you name the specific changes in a decade or two decades in your life? And we went up there and people didn't want to talk about that. And we came back to our sponsors and said, they want to talk about a bunch of other stuff, including addiction and family violence and power and corruption and all these things that were complicated for the big public funder. They didn't want it, they weren't looking for that. And I thought that, well, that's the problem when a research project expects to colonize a community and there are a bunch of redevelopment processes they really have their agenda and they're creating a false sense of participation. And then when the stories come back that actually interfere with the policy they intended, they don't change the policy. They just stop listening. So to me, the trick is not to be involved in an advocacy campaign where this, the answer is already there. Be involved in an advocacy campaign that's going to emerge from the grassroots listening, and it may not be what you wanted or intended. And now you have to deal with, shifting the priorities of the policy approach. We did that around HIV awareness in South Africa with a bunch of NGOs, in which the obvious thing was prevention, things like prophylactics. And a bunch of people decided, the issue was male supremacy. And the work needed not to be done with women survivors of violence and women, people that ended up with AIDS because of lack of public health safety. But we need to talk to men about why they were. And so we did this project called Men as Partners. That work ended up being shown at the South African Congress to have the men who were in the room, there were women leaders as well, but not as many as there were men, take some responsibility for the way they talk about the world, not just about sex. It's the way they actually, engage the world, which is to dominate it. And that dominance behavior was what needed to be examined. And these stories were asking, everybody to consider that. How much change it made, I don't know. But the policy around HIV/AIDS got a lot better. And those of you that know South Africa's history, it took them a long time to decide this was a public health problem. And it changed because men took responsibility for that public health problem.
I think we have time for one more question. Did someone over here have a question? Sure. Yeah, come on up.
Hello, my name is Kai, and my question was really similar to the last one, but I guess just to follow up, I'm working with a community that is extremely interested in framing their story in ways that actively intercept like technologies of development and policy that are, you know, when you were talking about communities being bulldozed, we've spent the last week like sitting on concrete barricades and bulldozers. So they are very interested in using story to intercept policies. So I guess like, if that's not the necessarily like direct route that you want to frame a story, how can you best like sort of more indirectly, as you were describing in South Africa, sort of frame stories that will eventually trickle down and influence technologies of development and change that are very policy based, like specifically right now, like Caltrans and city officials.
Yeah, you guys probably know that, I'm gonna speak about work in West Oakland, where policy around diesel fuel, both from the port, but mainly from all the trucks coming in and out, that there was a lot of story work done. There was also good research about asthma rates and about, you know, ancillary impact of pollutants on communities and over long-term health cycles. But there were also just stories. And we were part of, you know, a couple of projects. One was called the Goods Movement. It was a statewide project where we were working with a lot of them. But one was called Ditching Dirty Diesel. It was kind of straight ahead. I think the website's still out there somewhere. But we were just part of their, you know, the community organization doing the work and partnered with a lot of the West Oakland-based organizations were, you know, basically doing survey processes that would have been, you know, research, you know, just a normal qualitative research model of case studies by this individual, that individual, about the impact. And the stories just added a little more emotive awareness about it, I think, in terms of hearing the voice of somebody that spent a little time considering exactly the way you want to say it. And then you just use those stories as you do, whether you're using it for your, you know, broader public information campaign or doing things like bringing it to the, you know, Port of Oakland's concerns. But you may know they changed a lot of policy around goods movement in Oakland, you know, like you couldn't leave your truck idling and you know, then they're trying to get people out of diesel use and trying to even with the bus system and other things, try to move toward that, because each one of those stories added up to, we get it. You've hit us enough that we can't get away from your argument. I don't know that there's there's no trick to getting the dynamic of listening and creating stories, you know, whatever form they take, to get it to work really perfectly. There's just time of investing and being consistent and being sure that your agenda and your confirmation bias is not overly written over what you're actually hearing. And I think that's, you know, there's still a trick for a lot of organizations. That's why I said it's knowledge plus story plus love plus place that makes a liberatory moment. You need all of that. You don't need just place. You don't need story. You need, you know, you need absolute, you know, real concern. And that's a good place to stop, huh, Melody?
Thank you, Joe. Thanks for coming.
Thank you guys for this ridiculous way. I wish I could have been there. I tried to get somebody from my staff to just show up so you'd see a real StoryCenter person. But we're all busy this day, and we appreciate your time. And feel free to email me, Melody. I will send you the slides. And obviously you did the recording, so you can share it with whoever you want to. And you can learn more about StoryCenter if you just check out storycenter.org.
Sounds great. And we'll keep you looped into our conversation the rest of the semester.
And give my best to Susan. I didn't say hello to Susan. Wherever you are, Susan. Hello, Susan. We miss you. Brooke and I miss you, Susan.
You guys have to come back up and visit.
We will be doing that for sure. Both my kids are still there.